all comes down. So obviously the head has a nucleus that has half the amount of genetic material it needs. Okay, so that's it, half, because obviously when it joins with an egg that has the other half, we create a human. Okay, nice and simple. All right on the top of it, the acrosome is a specialized penetrating area with digestive enzymes, basically, that allow you to penetrate the egg. Okay, so you know how you say that one sperm wins the race? Well, it's not actually the case. Okay, so hundreds, if not thousands of sperm win the race and weaken the side of the egg wall as it comes through. Weakens, weakens, weakens. And then eventually, one opportune sperm, basically, when the egg's weak enough, comes through and finally gives it the final blow that allows it to go in. So the amount of sperm that's produced during an ejaculation is anywhere between 50 million and 150 million sperm that are released during an ejaculation. Now, the body registers low sperm production, okay, or infertile sperm production, as 20 million per mil of sperm that is produced. Okay, so we're talking about enormous numbers of sperm that gets released. From there, we have the midpiece. Now, the midpiece is a highly compact mitochondria base. Okay, and this allows for rapid energy production to allow enough energy for the flagellum or the tail to be fueled in order to move, so the sperm can spin. Okay, so let's have a look at our hormones. So obviously this whole process is coordinated by hormones, okay, and it's a feedback system. So in the presence of low testosterone, or the need for more testosterone, or the need for more sperm, the hypothalamus secretes the gonadotropic releasing hormone. Okay, that's obviously one of the stimulating hormones that gets released to the anterior pituitary gland. And from the anterior pituitary gland, they release follicle stimulating and luteinizing hormones. Now, I know you guys have heard of these before, but most of the time when we speak about these hormones, we're speaking about the menstrual cycle. So both of them actually play a role in the production of testosterone and the production of sperm. So we actually have a condition or a state known as the hypothalamus pituitary testes axis, which just means that each one of these hormones that are produced, if one of them is out or if something influences them, it actually has a relay effect on the other two as well. So if you produce too much hormone or too much testosterone, and essentially the message is fed back to pituitary to stop, which is fed back to the hypothalamus to stop as well. Okay, so it's a proper axis and they work together in order to produce the hormones that we need. Okay, but we'll stick with the left side for starters. So we'll look at what the follicle stimulating hormone does. So that stimulates the Sertoli cell to do one of two things. The first one is the production of an androgen binding protein. Okay, now this aids in sperm production. Okay, so if the androgen binding protein wasn't there, as the interstitial cell or the Leydig cells produced testosterone, then just through normal diffusion, the testosterone will be spread between the testes and the blood. Okay, what the androgen binding protein allows is for higher concentrations of testosterone to stay within the testicles themselves. Okay, so the concentration is actually 20 to 50 times the amount of testosterone can be found in testicles compared to blood because of your androgen binding protein. Okay. Now, the luteinizing hormone that stimulates the interstitial or the Leydig cells, okay, and that produces your androgens. Okay, the main one being testosterone. Now, as the testosterone levels builds up in the blood, it gets a little bit too much. It actually has a negative feedback system, and increased testosterone will actually cause the release of a hormone called Inhibin, and that there turns off the anterior pituitary gland, if you will, and no more luteinizing hormone is released, or reduction in luteinizing hormone is released from there. Okay, so once the sperm is produced and it's gone through the epididymis. From there, during sexual stimulation, the sperm will actually move up the vas deferens. Now, vas deferens goes over the top of the bladder and then it comes down. Once it meets the seminal vesicles, about 60% of the total semen is produced there. Okay, so sperm only makes up about 5% of the total volume of semen. So 60% of that volume, it comes from the seminal vesicles themselves. Okay, so you've got two seminal vesicles and they secrete this fluid into it. Now, this fluid is a highly alkaline solution and it has a whole bunch of fructose, energy, and prostaglandin to aid in the sperm survival as it travels into the vaginal passage. Okay, so the vaginal passage is extremely acidic by nature, okay, because it needs to be in order to protect itself. So if sperm was to be released out of there, then without the alkaline substance, then the sperm would die within the acidic environment. Okay, so that's basically it. Now, it's also got full of sugar. The mitochondria of each sperm can actually have enough fuel to travel along, okay, because it is a very long distance in which they have to travel, and it's a very harsh environment as well. As it comes along a little bit further, okay, the prostate is also stimulated, and that's increased your milky 30%. Now, this one is slightly acidic, okay, and within this particular fluid as well, it has any bacteria within the actual semen or along the track to be killed so they don't end up using the sperm as its fuel source. Okay. Now the last little gland that we have, okay, two of them, the Cowper's gland. These ones here, they can become part of the semen itself, but most of the time, this is what produces the pre-cum. Okay, that's what we always call it. So the Cowper's gland comes out and it secretes this clear solution and it alkalizes the urethra. It kills any bacteria that's found within the urethra and it essentially lubricates it as well. So when it comes to the point of ejaculation, the semen itself has a clear, alkaline, smooth runway, if you will. Okay, so that's what the Cowper's glands do. And all of this is obviously controlled by neural stimulation, which we'll have a look at. Okay, so once we get to the point of needing to use sperm, obviously the first thing that happens is the erection is formed. Now, an erection comes mostly from sexual stimulation, okay, but as the boys know here, it can also happen for no reason at all. You can actually get an erection without your brain even really knowing about it, okay? It can happen as a base of baroreceptors within the bladder being too high. Vibrations coming through your legs. Doesn't really need too much of a stimulus in order to get an erection, but it's controlled by the parasympathetic.